All right. Have you or has someone you know served on a jury? And what was it like? Or what do you think it would be like having to decide whether someone was guilty or innocent? And we have chilling, rewarding, painful, fun, other.
I was a foreman, and oh my goodness, that was an experience, I want to tell you.
That.
I've been selected, but I've never had an attorney allow me to be on a jury.
I've been selected. I tell them I'm in the insurance business. That was it.
Yeah, I've had juries I wouldn't have mind have been on, but after each attorney talked to me, they took me off. So.
I got interviewed for jury duty once in on a breach of contract case, and they found out I had taken a course in business law, and they dismissed me immediately.
That's weird. I've been called but never even been interviewed. I guess the advantage of having your last name start with W.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
And think about that, Greg. That's true.
Yeah.
I will tell you, they need folks like you on these juries, so don't get off of them. When I was a foreman and had the rest of this group, I thought there is no way I would ever want to be sitting over there and having these peers judge me because these people were off the charts. I'm serious. It was awful.
Oh, that's funny.
Oh
Yeah, I
man.
know. I'd love to serve. I'd love watching Perry Mason and Matlock.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's the thing though, is that the people that do re be really good on a jury usually have a way to get out of it. So
That is
That's true.
correct. I could tell you that experience, but literally it would take this entire time to tell you guys about that experience. So I won't do that, but it was incredible.
Have you ever seen the movie 12 Angry Men with Henry Fonda? It's
Yeah.
actually
Yeah.
star-studded. It's an amazing movie.
Great
Yeah.
movie. Great movie.
Yeah.
It is.
And they tried to remake that, but it just wasn't as good as the
No.
I'd love to see that in a play. I mean, it's set perfectly for a play because it's like
Right.
one scene, you know? Yeah.
I'll tell you one
So.
thing. I'll tell you one thing how bad this really was. I thought, like the second day when I had everybody in the jury room, that I thought it was a setup and I was being punked. There were cameras in here and people were going to walk in and say, "Oh, you are great," and da 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 da. And it was a setup. That's how bad this thing.
You're on candid camera,
Yeah, exactly.
huh?
Oh my.
Wow.
Incredible.
Sounds like you had a bunch of winners.
No, I did. I had a guy who claimed to be a voice expert. He was in the insurance business, and he said, "I know that's not the guy who did it because I'm a voice expert." And I said, "I thought you were in the insurance business." He goes, "I am, but I can tell voices, and that's not his voice." I said, "That's really strange because the defendant has not spoken a word yet." That's just one example. Wow.
He's a lip reader too.
Oh my God. I'm telling you. Oh.
Mind reader, maybe so.
Was
Yeah.
it a civil or a criminal case?
It was criminal. It was a bank robber.
Was his name Spock?
His name, get a load of this. His first name was actually Daryl. Yeah.
Well, they should have disqualified you right away.
I tried everything to get out of that. I couldn't believe they chose me. But again, I won't get into it. It'll take the whole time.
Right.
What should you have gotten in trouble for as a kid but got away with? And how guilty did you feel? Stealing, skipping school, speeding,
Well,
maybe.
I think I have to take every one of those.
Yeah.
Sometime in your life, you probably, when you get my age, you get And did I feel guilty? Probably not in those times. It was like an achievement. You got by with it. But
today, yeah,
I would have, yeah.
Gary, I'd like to be your age again.
Well, my birthday is next week. I'll be 77.
Mm.
And we don't celebrate anymore. I just kind of secretly don't let anybody know it's coming except you guys that it was okay. But So somebody asked me how old I am. I tell them I'm 49.
Yeah, that's believable. Okay, Rick, I didn't have anything for you to read, but this is Steve's just one page. So.
Oh, just one page. Thank you.
Well, the type's smaller, too.
Okay.
So.
As the scripture says, anyone who trusts in him will never be put to shame, for there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. But not all the Israelites accepted the good news. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our message? Consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ. But I ask, do they not hear? Of course they did. Their voice was gone out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. Again I ask, did Israel not understand? First Moses says, I will make you envious by those who are not a nation. I will make you angry by a nation that has no understanding. And Isaiah boldly says, I was found by those who did not seek me. I revealed myself to those who did not ask for me. But concerning Israel, he says, all day long I have held out my hands to a disobedient and obstinate people.
Okay, the initial comments on this.
Lots of Old Testament references.
Yeah, significant. And I've pulled those and inserted them when we go through this study here. So, oh, I didn't number these questions. Oh, I don't want to do that. Well, I'm good. Normally they come up. I thought maybe I erased those, the animations. Okay. So you know a little bit more what's coming. All right.
We won't read ahead, Dwight.
Yeah.
We're on the honor system.
All right, great.
Can we start with number 8 and go back to 1?
Yeah. So last week ended with verse 13. Which is for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And then asked this week in verse 14, how can they call on the one they have not believed in? So verse 13 is quoted from Joel 2:32. From the context of Joel, I've got more of it here. From the context of Joel, what does that add to the evangelism implied in verse 14? So I've got a little bit more than so down at the bottom here, but in Joel, so I'll read this. After this, I will pull out my spirit on all humanity. Then your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your old men will have dreams and young men will see visions. I will even pour out my spirit on the male and female slaves in those days. I will display wonders in the heavens and on the earth, blood, fire, and columns of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the great and awe-inspiring day of the Lord comes. Then everyone who calls on the name of Yahweh will be saved, for there will be an escape for those on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem, as the Lord promised among the survivors of the Lord Paul. So from the context of that passage in Joel, that they quoted in verse 14. What does that add to the evangelism message implied in verse? Well, what was I trying to work for? Anyway, so does the passage that the of Joel that this was taken from, I mean, if you get to put it more in context, what does that add to the evangelism implied in verse 14? I know when I make up questions, it's kind of hard to get what I was thinking of, but.
Well, is Joel referencing the final coming of Christ?
Yeah, you're kind of on that trend, yes.
So. When you were another Bible study I'm in, as I said before, we're in Revelation, and Joel sounds so much like what Revelation is talking about. So at the end of time, with the seven seals and the scripture, and that. So it's, yeah. It sounds very much like that.
So what does this add to the evangelism that is implied in verse 14?
That there's a second chance?
Second chance? Yeah.
Well, I guess judgment day, so to speak, right? Or
yeah. So
is that what you're thinking?
Yeah, that's kind of what I'm thinking. And that it taking that verse out of context, you maybe don't pick up on that there's a certain urgency implied in evangelism.
Yeah.
That's what I was looking for, but again, who knows what I'm thinking when I'm putting this together.
Nothing good happens after midnight, right, Dwight?
No, that's right.
Perfect.
So anyway, that's what I thought. So in the Old Testament, calling on the name of the Lord was a metaphor for worship and prayer. Does that understanding of the phrase add anything to verse 14? So I'll read verse 14 again. So how then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? So that actually refers to verse 13 now that I'm looking at this. Boy, I should take more coffees, but together. So it's actually verse 13. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. So if it actually is calling on the name of the Lord is a metaphor for worship and prayer, what does that add to verse 13, I guess, is the question. Or verse 14.
Well, I think to some extent it qualifies the fact those who call on the Lord tend to be challenged and driven to the fact that.
Yeah, I think, well, I mean, how can they worship and were you going to say something, Steve?
I was kind of thinking that's kind of a response to it, right? Worship and prayer is a response to calling on the name of the Lord, right? That's our way of living that, right?
Right. Well, I think when I was, again, thinking about this as that, so how can they, if it was a phrase used to kind of imply worship and prayer, so maybe the Paul is talking about, well, how do they know even who to pray to, or how do they know who they can even worship? So again, another I thought was a call for the Israelites to and others to remember the need for evangelism. So
I mean, in the Old Testament, it was sacrificing. Right? Blood sacrificing was their way of worshiping God, right? I mean, it seemed like that was always part of the process until Christ came.
Right.
I know we use this a lot, but in 13, you can say, everyone who calls the name of the Lord will be saved, comma, just ask the thief on the cross.
Yeah.
Because that's all he did. He had none of these other, none of his background was anything about Christ and believing in him or anything, but he did call on him to be saved.
Yeah. Yeah, and again, that I just saw that thing came up on TikTok again, that the pastor talking about when that the guy on the cross comes to heaven, and
yeah,
we talked about this before. So
I love that.
Yeah. All right. A modeling Christian life is an important part of evangelism, but what else is needed?
And how can they hear without someone preaching to them?
Right. So, and again, I think, I have right here in question four. I think Paul is using preaching to mean more than just from the pulpit. Your thoughts?
You preach in every action you
right.
have.
Yeah. Yeah.
And 15 is interesting. And how can they preach unless they are sent?
Yeah.
What do you think that implies?
Well, it
is it the Holy Spirit sending, or
yeah, it could be the Holy Spirit or God sending, or
I think it's Holy Spirit,
or it's actually part of the part that the Israelites forgot the mission that God actually gave them to spread the word. Good news. They got so inner focused that they forgot all about that. Okay, in our media rich environment today, has anything really replaced preaching in person?
No.
That was an easy question. What does it take to get the message of God to someone, according to 14 through 15? And these last questions are all kind of on this page, are pretty you much. Get, go ahead.
According to those, it's you need to be sent and you need to go.
Well, there's actually six steps, which are actually eight was not supposed to come up. It was supposed to come after seven. You wouldn't be able to see it. But through all this, so Paul kind of in talks in the reverse order. So he starts out in this 14 and talks about the person being saved and that they are called, the election that we've talked about. They believe. No, yeah, I'm not going the right way.
Yeah, you are.
Then they hear. If they not heard, and how can they hear without someone preaching to them, and how can that someone preach to them if they've not been sent? So Paul actually starts from 13 and goes through this backwards. So, but that's the sense of what he's doing. Send, preach, hear, believe, called, and saved.
Dwight, when I go back to number five, what's your definition of in person? Because you utilize media all the time. And I think of Jonathan Kahn this week when you sent out the link on his video. That was extremely moving preaching that I actually shared with a lot of people myself. So I'm interested to see what you mean by.
Well, I think the sense that I was getting from this, and I guess what I meant with that is that, yeah, we have all these media tools, but the thing that has the most impact, I think, is personal testimony and one-on-one when you share the gospel. So as you can see, I mean, it's that interaction with, you're looking at a person in his eyes, you can sense their sincerity, or you can really get a feel for what their experience was with that personal relationship with Christ. So I think, yeah, we can get lots of great things and great preaching or even in sermons online. So, but I think.
See, I think you're right. I think that from what I experienced by, say, I'll use Jonathan Kahn again, which you sent out, it sparks person to person, face to face conversations. It's right. Kind of a lead in to take you to another step.
Right. No, I agree.
I think though, Gary, you got to be careful because I know a lot of people
that will comfortably sit with their phone in their hand and listen, or with their computer on their lap and watch, but they will not engage, because they'll tell you, oh yeah, yeah, I listen to the sermons from my bed Sunday morning, or I listen to all these little snippets of preaching, but they'd never go to the step of face-to-face, reaching out. You know, this all comes back to John with his head on the chest of Jesus. Yeah. That's what you can't do with video and all these technologies. And yeah. That is the example of what you need to do, in my opinion. I think that's why it's there.
No, I don't disagree. To me, it's almost number five needs a caveat that that's just
another tool.
Yeah.
Another tool. Yeah.
No, thank you to that next level. I agree. You're traveling. When you travel, you know that everybody in the airport's got a phone on their ear. So, I agree. But the one thing that moves the guys I work with, and Chuck, you're on, is they respond to media, and then you take it from there to that next step. But because of where these people are at today, they respond to media, but then you got to take them to the next step.
And I don't think I was not discounting anything from media or even watching. I'm sure there's a number of people from watching the Billy Graham crusade that anyway came to a better understanding of Christ or the gospel message. But then there needs to be that personal interaction, or the action, which Greg was talking about, was missing on just watching the video too. So, and that can more be facilitated in a personal discussion. Yeah. So.
There was several months ago, there was Caleb in the morning show. They were talking about, people that worship from home, whether online or watching a recorded message, and why do they do that? And a gal called in, young gal, she said her and her husband attends, a mega church where there's, several hundred people in the sanctuary on Sundays. And she said, we'll never go back. And the reason she gave is, she goes, we're in a small group, and we meet weekly. And she said, what this has allowed her and her husband to do is when they listen to the sermon, they stop the sermon and they have discussions. And she says, our relationship has, increased multiple, we never really had, one-on-one discussions about God and the gospel, until this media became available and we started worshiping at home. I thought that was very interesting. Her response to that.
So. But she was saying she did that in a small group, not just with her husband.
Correct. Correct, Greg. I think that's an important part as well. Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So community. Yeah.
But I don't know that I would ever, that I could miss, I could not go to corporate worship. I don't know.
Well, it's interesting. I think you have the same problem if all you do is go to church on Sunday for an hour.
Right.
It's the same problem.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Oh, this was for the last. See, I didn't number these, so this should have come up on another question. But anyway, in Isaiah 52:7, the last phrase in 15 is what is from. Isaiah, it says, how beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who proclaims peace, who brings glad tidings of good things, who proclaims salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. So. All right. From verse 16, how can we deduce that some Israelites did accept the gospel? But not all the Israelites accepted the good news, for Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed your message?
And well, right in the first sentence.
Yeah, yeah. That was a give me question.
Mm-hmm.
Why was I going to read more verse? Why did Paul use this quote from Isaiah 53? I mean,
kind of a way of saying that doubting Thomas was not the first doubter.
Okay, so yeah, this Isaiah 53, I'll just read a part of it. It starts out, it says, who has believed what we have heard, and who has the arm of the Lord been revealed to? So he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of the dry ground. He didn't have an impressive form or majesty that we should look at him, no appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by man, a man of suffering who knew what sickness was. He was like someone people turned away from. He was despised and we didn't value him. So it goes on. So what's that passage talking about? Who's that passage talking about? Who is Isaiah 53? Who is that talking about? I'll read a little bit further. Yet he himself bore our sicknesses and he carried our pains.
Jesus.
So, all right, thanks.
When in doubt.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, so I think that's why, and again, as we've talked before, is that especially with the Jewish audiences, you could, and Jesus did this a lot, we talked about that, but you could quote just a verse from the Old Testament or passages, and people would know what you're talking about, or they would finish the meaning, or they pick up the whole meaning. So I guess for the Gentiles, when Paul would say this, they would not make any connection beyond about with Christ or the Messiah, but the Jewish listeners would pick up on that. So
that, I think that's the key, is what, when we talk about, and I've heard this before in passages, that the Jewish people that were non-Israelites or non-believers, they were listening, and we often say, you're listening to me, but you're not hearing me.
Yeah.
That's something you say to your kids, right?
Yeah, right. So yep. they were listening, but they weren't hearing the message. In fact, they were using that against, you know, Jesus.
Well, you need to pray for discernment.
Yeah.
So you can tell the difference between the two.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, this is what I added. I guess I didn't need to look at another way because I added it down here. So, all right. Does bringing people this wonderful good news guarantee a welcome?
Heck no.
Yeah. Oh, no. I mean, it's what Gary said. You might hear me, but you're not listening.
Yeah. So according to verse 18, did they not hear? Of course they did. So is it possible that Israel did not hear either in Isaiah's day, in Jesus' day, or in Paul's day, according to verse 18? So is it possible they did not hear? So what I asked, did they not hear? Of course they did. It says, their voice has gone out into all the earth and the words to all the ends of the world. So, which is actually quoting Psalm 19. It says, yet their message has gone throughout the earth and their words to all the world. God has made a home in the heavens for the sun. So
remember the Simon and Garfunkel song years ago, People Hearing Without Listening, The Sounds of Silence?
Actually, one of the commentators did mention that too. Thanks, Dick. So, Oh, no, I know what it was. I was interesting how that ties in now that you mentioned it. I was reading another booklet, which I started a book with by Mario Murillo, and he's talking about, we should not be silent in this time of everything's counter to our beliefs. But so, yeah, Sounds of Silence, that's a good tie in here. What area do you imagine is covered by the end? Oh, the
ends of the earth.
Ends of the world.
We went from hearing and listening to learning how to read or spell.
Yeah, spell. I wonder how that E got fell off. I'll look for it here on my desk. No.
I got to ask you, Dwight, when I used to belong to this, when we were face-to-face, the last person in had to buy breakfast. So doesn't Tony have to buy breakfast today? He just joined us.
Well, actually, that...
Good morning, Tony.
Morning.
Good morning. I can buy breakfast, but I don't know how you're going to get it.
Well, you can enjoy it.
Thank you.
Do you think that the ends of the world refer to the fact that God and his creation and his sovereign nature are embedded in and are woven into the everything you see in the world, so anybody here sees it?
Yeah, I think that's part of it too, but I think when I was in I hadn't been thinking about that when I did this question either, but I think I was just wondering the ends of the world, but was it really more the known world to them at the time? Maybe just the Roman Empire
Well, I don't know. I mean, Genesis is the whole world,
right?
They don't talk about just the pieces they were standing on. It's the whole thing. It's interesting because if you've ever been on a mission trip out into the wilderness, I was in the rainforest of Costa Rica, those people had not heard the word, right?
Yeah.
But they were standing in an incredible, intricately woven creation that they recognized. So I don't know. It is interesting what that was referring to.
Yeah. And, you know, that too, they had never heard the word of God, but then as Paul has talked, maybe it's in Romans or some other places, you know, maybe you haven't received the word, but can you, just looking around you, don't you realize there is a God? So there's that too. All right. How did Israel not understand? I'm gonna ask, did Israel not understand?
Yeah, it's interesting because it's not an event either. They just continually didn't understand.
Yeah, as we talked about a couple earlier lessons too, is that in the five books of Moses, I mean, it's all through there. It's not by the law, but it's more about faith.
I think that's probably the answer, though, that they didn't understand, because their translation from law into what Jesus was talking about with faith was totally against their past belief in themselves, was that they had to follow the law, and it was by acts, not by believing in Jesus Christ. So they were into sacrifice and all of those things that Jesus now shows up and says, no, that's not what it's about anymore.
Well, actually, God said that's not what it's about.
Yeah.
In the first five books of the Bible, too.
Right.
They wanted to go on. I guess they really didn't get that faith part because.
Yeah. I don't know. I think they did, Dwight, because 400 years of slavery and they continued to come back to him, and 40 years of wandering and they continued to come back to him. They had to have faith. Well,
the question rises, and you're right, they did. The question was, they didn't have faith in Jesus. They didn't think it was Jesus. In fact, they are so messed up when you read Revelation. Some of the commentaries we're reading right now is that the Jewish people at that time, they believed that even with John saying these are the end of times when it comes, he talks about the past and the present and then the future. But their belief was that possibly when all that happens is the Antichrist, they believe that could be Jesus. That is the second coming.
Well, I think they had faith. I think they didn't have consistency.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and I don't know whether to talk more about the common Israelites. I mean, that would be an interesting question. Whether the common Israelites had a lot of faith, the Pharisees and those were more about religion. So they focus more on the religion than the faith part, I think. So
they love their control.
The yeah. power, they tasted power and it overwhelmed them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
No one escapes that.
Yeah.
Except for Steve. I think he's Steve. He escapes.
Yeah. So how is God making Israel envious? So in Deuteronomy, I actually said that. Sometimes I have trouble saying Deuteronomy. They arouse my jealousy by worshiping things that are not God. So first they make God envious, maybe because they were worshiping idols. So they provoke my anger with their useless idols. Now I'm going to make them jealous through people who are not even a people. I will provoke their anger through the foolish Gentiles. So that's
an interesting statement out of Deuteronomy, because I have trouble thinking God can be envious.
Yeah. Well, can he be jealous? Well, it does say in Exodus, he's a jealous God.
I think he can. Well, I think he can be envious for those he's lost to other gods. I don't know. That's a weird one, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
Well, I mean, it's difficult when you're using words that apply to us and applying them to God, because he's so much more than we are. But I guess there's really a tough way to describe how God would be jealous or envious. It's not like we are. Or
I think what is true is he pursues us,
right?
If he doesn't get us, then he's envious of whatever did. I think that's true. I think that really is true.
So anyway, it's just giving people back back doing the same thing what they've done to him pretty much. So what does he hope to accomplish by making the Israelites jealous?
He wants to win them.
Yes, he wants it.
Wants their love.
Right. Yep. So yeah, that's his end game. He doesn't know. What do you think about the fact that even Moses and Isaiah talk about God's salvation going beyond the Israelites? So Deuteronomy would be something that Moses had said from God. Isaiah would be where he says, I revealed myself to those who didn't even ask to know me. Those who did not seek me found me. I said to a nation that did not call my name, here I am, here I am. I will help you.
It's a sentiment that Jesus repeated and instructed. I mean, he was here for everybody.
Yeah. Which is what the Israelites.
In a way of saying, I want to help you.
Yeah. So all that, what kind of impresses me as we read some of the Old Testament and is that a lot of the things we think are New Testament or Jesus saying things, they actually Jesus was saying them in the Old Testament as well to the people. I mean, it recorded in the scriptures, God's word. He's going after everybody. So what does verse 21 or 65:2 Isaiah say to you about God? But concerning Israel, it says, all day long I've held out my hands to a disobedient and obstinate people. Or which is a quoted from this Isaiah, day after day I graciously outstretched my hands to a people who turned their backs to me, whose way of life is corrupt and who insist on going their own way after their own thoughts. What does it say to you about God?
Loving, merciful, slow to anger.
God's saying, I've got a better way for you.
Yes.
I'm always here.
Yep.
Always pursuing.
Always pursuing.
Yep.
And surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
Mm-hmm.
as Joseph Prince says, he will hunt you down. Grace and mercy will hunt you down.
You know, as human beings, we tend to leave people after struggling with them for so long. We finally give up and just leave and go on. Whereas God never does that. God's with them all the time. Regardless.
Yeah.
That's interesting, Daryl, because I think Jesus talked about it when he was sending the guys out two by two, that there's going to be places that don't accept you, and they're, brush yourself off and move on to the next. Kind of like it's my problem, not yours, right?
And how uncomfortable those guys were with that.
Yeah. Yeah.
They just did not care for that at all. Yeah, but that's what Jesus said would happen, and it did.
Yeah, and some of them.
I think it's interesting that you read that verse, surely goodness and mercy will follow me for the rest of my life. I always thought of that as I wanted it to follow me, but it's not. It's following me whether I want it to or not.
Yeah,
right. How many times you heard people say, I'm going to pray for you. And they say, stop praying for me. And I think that's a result of them realizing what prayer means, and it's there all the time. And they would rather not have that, but you know it's there, and God's always there.
Yeah, why would you not want somebody to pray for you? So.
Right. Bunch of answers to that one.
Because your heart is hardened.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. Or I'm not worth praying about.
Yeah, and then that also kind of ties into, again, some of the things we talked about. If you're not praying, you're not preaching to people, then the people that God has chosen or God has elected may never hear the message. So mm-hmm. I'll never have the chance to respond. So according to these 19 through 21, and I'll read these again. Again, I asked, did Israel not understand? First, Moses says, I will make you envious of those who are not a nation. I will make you angry by a nation that has no understanding. And Isaiah boldly says, I was found by those who did not seek me. I revealed myself to those who did not ask for me. But concerning Israel, he says, all day long I held up my hands to a disobedient, obstinate people. So why can't the Jews blame their unbelief on the fact that they can't understand the word of Christ?
They heard it in the Old Testament too.
Yeah.
They don't want to admit they can't understand the word of Christ.
Yeah.
They don't want to believe he is the word. That's what the problem is.
Right. He's not who they expected.
No.
I always like it that we can say the Jews, they're the ones that didn't get it. When the reality is when we say they, we mean we.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, I don't mean me. I mean you guys. But I feel bad for you.
No, we got that. So.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So, just clarify.
Yeah. So I mean, yeah. So that last closing statement: all day long, I've held out my hands to a disobedient, obstinate people. That's us. Just yep. Like is the Jews. So.
I met the enemy, and the enemy is me.
Yeah. Oh, that's
Walt Kelly, Pogo.
Yeah, I read those all the time. When I was younger, I thought it was, you know, like reading a comic book, but you know, really, it had a lot of political and other very adult stuff, and it wasn't so much a kid's comic strip. That's what we need more of today, something like Pogo.
Kind of like Rocky and Bullwinkle.
Well, explain that one to me, Greg.
When I was a kid, I watched Rocky and Bullwinkle, and I thought it was really funny. It was great. I grew up, and I was showing my kids Rocky and Bullwinkle because they were saying, oh, these are real cartoons. I said, well, let's watch these. So I start watching them with them. And then I realized that it was written at two levels. It was written at a kid's level and it was written at an adult's level. And there are all kinds of really racy adult themes in that cartoon. And one of them that comes to mind is they go into a town called Double Dome. And it is the main feature of the town is two domes that look like women's breasts. I mean, really like women's breasts. I'm going, wait a minute. I don't remember seeing that when I was a kid.
Huh. Oh, so I thought it was maybe the conflict with communism or.
Oh, there were political themes in there too, yeah.
Boris.
So I think. Oh, okay, I got more. Oh, how is the story of the prodigal son like Israel?
Give me my inheritance and let me go. Not sure about the end, though.
I was going to say, how's the ending going to...
Yeah, till I run out of gas and come back looking for more.
Well, that's kind of that is kind of Israel's. Because when they worship God and everything, they're real successful, then they take all his goodness and riches and prosperity and go out and spend it on their own pleasure and disobeying God and everything else. They turn away from him.
I think the end of the story for the Israelites hasn't played out yet, though.
No, I would agree.
But, yeah.
But if God is the father in the story, I mean, he's just waiting for them to show up on the horizon.
And but then who is the older brother?
Right. That's what I was going to say, Greg. That's us, right?
I would assume so.
Yeah.
Or
we're in the presence and then we're distraught, right?
Yeah. Or the older brother is the Israelites.
Or the question here, the other question I had is how are the religious leaders of Israel like the prodigal's older brother?
Oh, that's probably a better analogy.
Yeah.
See, you can think at 2 in the morning.
So that was, but I have no really no real takeaways, but there's some other heavier kind of questions. So we must take God's great message of salvation to others so that they can respond to the good news. How will our loved ones and neighbors hear about Christ unless someone tells them? Is God calling you to be a part of making his message known to your community? And besides thinking of a person who needs to hear the good news, think of something you can do to help that person hear it. Then take that step as soon as possible. So that was one commentary on the earlier part of this passage. And given your personal experience in churches you have attended, how burdened is the church today for the salvation of Israel? How well informed is the average believer about where Israel fits in the present and future of God's salvation story? Any thoughts on that?
We probably don't focus on that very much, frankly. We focus more on people we feel don't know God, but are not necessarily Jewish.
Yeah, but there's a lot of things that actually tie us to Israel. So that's unfortunate. So, I mean, everybody, a lot of people, when they talk about Israel now, they don't even make that connection on why they're an important part of our story as Christians. Okay, I didn't have anything to think about. I started something down, but then I just couldn't find anything. So unbelief is a result of the choice not to believe. With the final barrage of scriptures from the Old Testament, Paul proves his point that in spite of sovereign election from God's side of the equation, Israel is in a state of unbelief by her own choice. Personal responsibility is part of the ministry of the gospel, both in delivering it and in choosing whether or not to receive it. God's responsibility was to get the gospel to Israel. It was Israel's responsibility to act on it. All right, so any other comments on the passage?
This sort of reminds me of the, and I've mentioned this before, my wife's favorite picture of Christ is him standing at the gate with a latch on the other side.
Yeah. Yeah, that's.
We've got to let him in.
Yeah. And he's knocking.
Yep.
So again, that's just like this passage we're talking about. God's not, doesn't give up. I mean, he's there.
Mm-hmm.
He's pursuing us. He's knocking at the door. Okay. We got one more chapter on Israel, chapter 11. So, and I got to be careful. I mean, sometimes I kind of follow the division on a couple of the lessons or division by the commentary. And then kind of like this passage, I was going, well, should I actually have followed their division there? Or should I have done it differently? But anyway, fortunately, you guys helped me get through it. So
what's interesting, Dwight, is that, you know, I think I mentioned I'm in another Bible study on Romans. When you get to chapter 12, a lot of the questions you asked today are answered in 12. And I was just reading right now. I knew, but I'm not going to divulge them today because we're going to do 12. But a lot of what we've been discussing is what, even this commentary, I'll read it to you. Many people use their contacts and relationships for selfish ambition. This is Paul's, by the way, from his scripture. They select people who will help them climb the social ladder. Jesus demonstrated and taught that we should treat all people with respect. Those of different race, those with disabilities, those with who are poor, young, or old, male, or female. We must never consider others as being beneath us in any way. Paul says we need to live in harmony with others and not to be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people. Are we able to do humble tasks with others? Do you welcome a conversation with unattractive, non-prestigious people? Are you willing to befriend newcomers and entry-level people? Or do you relate only to those who help you get ahead?
Yeah.
That's chapter 12. That's a commentary from chapter 12. So a lot of this ties together as you go along.
Well, that's kind of how Paul does it. I mean, he...
Yeah.
Builds up a lot of questions, curiosity, and then he answers it later, or he just sets the stage.
Yeah.
Okay. Any additions, corrections, updates? How's Pastor Bourne, Greg? I know it's on. Oh, Greg's not on. Oh, yeah, there he is.
I went to sunrise service on Sunday and he was there, and it was very inspirational. He's probably down to 100 pounds or so, but he was there, and it was just, it was special to see him. His family was kind of protecting him like bodyguards. They were sitting all around him, but his son-in-law is the lead preacher now, and he preached probably his best sermon that morning, and then he preached a different sermon for the normal service. And I know that he knew that he was only gonna, that David could only stay for the one. He only had the energy to stay for the one. And I heard a lot of people say, well, now he can go home.
Wow. Okay. All right. anything, any updates on Anna?
they're having their bachelorette party this weekend. So everybody's flying to San Francisco. Just they're super excited about that. She's been doing really well. So no, just praises that things are going well, and protection for everybody that's traveling this weekend, and that their visit would be blessed.
All right, guys, any additions, updates? All right, let's spend a moment in prayer here. Dear Father, we thank you so much for your word, and we're especially blessed by what Paul leads us and from the Romans and the epistles. And Father, it's just great to have Paul to read and study. It's really great to go through these passages with these guys too. So we thank you, God, for that.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
Lord, we thank you for the beautiful weather we've had, and the beautiful spring that we're experiencing. And I think it's another example of your sovereign power and your greatness and the way you've woven the world together. And we thank you for the time that Dwight's put in to help us be closer to you and understand your word. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
Our Father, we thank you for the life of Pastor Bourne, and I know there's a big celebration waiting for him here shortly. We ask you to continue to be with Anna and her family and those traveling this weekend, and just continue to bring healing and encouragement to her and the family. Father, there's so much going on in the world. We just ask that you help us to be strong, keep our faith in you, and we ask for your blessings, your protection, your provision for our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren. We ask these things in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen.
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 Amen. Have a great weekend, you guys.
Yep.
Yeah. Be blessed.
Yeah.